Well, the long hot summer is certainly underway. Got up only 98 today here. But I'm loving it. I'm ready for the long hot summer. Absolutely, I am. I tend to thrive under certain kind of pressure like this, and because to not thrive is to fail drastically. And I really set up my life such that if I don't succeed now, I'm really going to fail drastically, which so that's a wonderful push. I cannot even, failure is not an option. So I continue, though it's not easy. It requires tremendous motivation, and I got that motivation last night. Okay, out of the blue, out of nowhere, totally unexpected. Oh, I just made a fundamental shift, and I would say what happened is without trying to attach a hard label to it. So keep in mind, we are staying in the, we're dedicated to a part of our mind where we don't allow any hard labels to really form, any structure to form. We can put in words, but we don't let them form into any structure. We don't pursue the words, okay? But I gotta be careful. I don't want to imply some pathway, to a result. But what happened was there was this fundamental shift in how I saw every one of us, fundamental shift. Every one of us that's ever been in this world. And I'll just stick with this world instead of other planets in the universe, so we don't get too far out there. And I really was struggling. And today I was struggling as well. So this new way practice is actually having tremendous results, but it's really putting me through the ringer. Just like I want to go back to the world. I want to. I actually looked at the San Francisco Giants news for the first time in a couple years, I think. I'm not supposed to do that. That's pulling me back into bad habits, but I guess I was desperate for some old habits. And they're doing terrible, which is great. So there's no reason to follow them. But I said, why don't you sign Tim Lincecum? They have nobody in their bullpen. The freak is back. Why not bring Tim Lincecum back? Why? Because he's done it before over and over and over again. He's proven he has the mentality and everything to face up to the pressure. And so who's this? He's better than anyone they have right now. I'll tell you that. And he's out there. Tim, get on the phones and tell the Giants you're available. We'd love to have you back. A champion, a true champion. And so as I'm floundering these days, I realize, hey, I've done it. So I don't panic. I don't panic. There's a lot of pressure on me right now. But I say, no, I've done it before many times, and it'll work out. The Holy Spirit's got my back. The Dharma Kings have my back. And so the breakthroughs will arrive. I don't know what they will be, but they will arrive for sure. I'm very confident in that. And indeed, one did arrive, to say the least. And being silent about it is probably the best advice. Now, I've been looking at this book. Reading a dialogue on awakening. Whenever I come home, I open it up. I open it up. So all day long, I'm opening it up and just reading a snippet here, a snippet there, and getting this advice from Jesus, which is really sublime. The flavor, the confidence, the trust. Even on the cross, he trusted in his advice, his own advice, what he knew to be true. Even under tremendous pressure, he said, "No, I'm going to stay committed to it," and it worked for him. So when we're under on the cross now, under tremendous pressure, we need to also, trust in this advice. It will come through for us. And it did. It did for me last night. There's no doubt about it. Now, today's a day like any other. I'm struggling with trying to, chew out the world, and I'm saying, no. Let's go back to the way what Jesus said. Have the mind see the problem in a completely different way. Change your mind about the problem. Is there even a problem at all, actually? And back to the new way practice, which now I'm able to do in a very profound way. And it may be disturbing to some of you, but it's something that you can start getting used to. And these videos may be self-selective. And certainly, you want to practice it rather than turn it into a pathway. Okay, this is not a pathway we have here. It's a practice. It's very important to hear that. Now, initially, you might make it a pathway for a while. But at some point, you have to get to practicing it. Otherwise, it could have negative results. To try to turn profound practice into a pathway is never, never a good idea. But usually, first, you have to hear it. You have to hear it. You have to hear it. Maybe I've heard it for so long, but I kept stuck with it, saying, I got to see if I can't at least start implementing some sort of practice and try. And fortunately, I've been able to. Now, a lot of issues arose today. I was really struggling with them. What I do is I imagine I'm having a dialogue with Jesus. And I imagine, I state my rants, you know, then I go turn to Jesus and Jesus, what do you have to say about this, Jesus? And I try to imagine what Jesus would say back to me. And I find this very helpful, very, very helpful, because often the advice that I hear is very profound. I say, wow, that's great advice. I'm going to follow that. I am going to follow that. So I don't know if it's Jesus answering or it's me or just, you know, it's the one mind is just responding by doing this. I'm very familiar with what Jesus' style and you know, what he would emphasize. I feel that way. And he always brings us back to, you know, I ask the question, is it better to look at the world and all the turmoil and worry about that? What can we do about it? Or is it better just to practice? Which is the way? And the answer is better to practice. And he would say, I believe, I'm not suggesting to you that there isn't going to be turmoil in the world. What I'm suggesting to you is the best strategy for you is to not focus on the world at all, but to actually focus on this practice, because this practice is so helpful and profound, you cannot imagine how profound it is. And based on the experience I had last night, what he's saying is absolutely true. Absolutely true. I had a total reference shift. Total. A total reference shift. Meaning the totality of my expectations shifted. The totality of all my expectations shifted into a completely new frame of reference. So this devaluing, this reshaping of our expectations is working. To be able to do that, I didn't panic at all. I said, wow, I love this. I really, really love this. This is how I'd like to see it. This is the frame of reference I'd love to have. I love this. So there wasn't panic. So this is what Jesus is pointing out to us. He knows that by practicing in the right way, we will have this a shift of reference. Our frame of reference will shift totally. Total shift of our frame of reference. And all our expectations will be in this new frame of reference. And at that point, then we can maybe talk about the turmoil, so to speak. Can you handle it? Look at it from that viewpoint. And he wants us to have that frame of reference to view whatever turmoil there may be, rather than the frame of reference we have right now, because the turmoil may be such that we really do need that new frame of reference to be really effective and to be able to help. And I told Jesus, look, there's no guru in the world, no teaching, no guru, nothing. I can't find anything as a mentor to me, like saying, I want to be like that. This is something that I see as a mentor that I really want to follow their example. I can't find it. Never have been able to find it. So I said, well, you know, what do I do? And Jesus says, well, just trust it. Keep practicing. And then I found out that this new frame of reference is actually what we need. That's the true mentor. That's what will actually mentor us. It's not a guru, external guru. It's not an external teaching. It's literally this new frame of reference that will mentor us. And we're virtually there. We're virtually there. Hallelujah. Just in the nick of time. Because certainly the turmoil is coming. But we are not going to even pay any attention to that. We are going to continue to practice here. And take the advice of Jesus. Give him the benefit of the doubt. Why should we give the ego and Jesus equal benefit of the doubt? When Jesus tells us that's disastrous, choose one or the other. He's willing to say, you know what, I'd rather have you choose the ego than to try to please both of us. Okay? Because that'll really mess things up. The ego won't say that, but Jesus will. So what he's really saying is you have to choose one or the other. Please don't try to mix the two and make both truth and lies both true. That's what really gets you in trouble. Bad, bad trouble. But if we can give Jesus the benefit of the doubt, and he certainly earned it, hasn't he? Then let's give him the benefit of the doubt and say, okay, we'll do it your way. We'll do it your way. So, with this frame of reference shift, I'm able to now practice and give out practices that otherwise I might have held back a little bit on. I said, wow, this is really going to be difficult for everyone. Yes, but instead of having a negative experience from it, I had the most positive, super positive experience I've ever had in my life. So it didn't cause problems for me, just the opposite. That was after a very, very intense day and night of practice where I felt I really, really hit a home run. You know, really did what I needed to do, and indeed I did, absolutely. So we could say, I say, when we say I in a negative way, we're talking about the ego, the I. I can say, I can never be of any help at all. And what we're really meaning is the context of time can never be any help at all. The I really stands for, you could say, the context of time, the belief in time, space, process, form, which is really an imaginary attempt to induce abnormality in reality. So we use I in that context, a little I, as compared to the big I, you know, false self, true self, that kind of dichotomy here. I can never be of help to anyone. I will never be of help to anyone. Meaning the context of time will never be of help to anyone. Okay, we're saying that, but we want to personalize it to so we're reshaping our expectations. Okay, so we can say, I will never be of the slightest help in any way to anyone, to any context. I will never be able to help any context at all. I'm completely useless. I'll never be able to help anyone. I'll never be able to help anyone. Wow. I'll never be able to help anyone. Wow. So when we feel the shock of this, it's quite shocking to hear yourself saying this. But what we're really doing is getting reshaping our expectations so we place no stock at all in the context of time. And when we keep practicing this way, suddenly the context or a frame of reference will shift out of time. It will shift out of time. Out of that context. So I will never be able to help anyone in any way. I'm completely useless. Forever completely useless. I can never play a helpful role in any way. But there's no role for me to play at all. I don't have any role at all to play. I'll never have a role to play. I will never have a role to play. So for me now, this doesn't bother me so much. It's I've already gotten past the point where this really hits hard because I have a lot of confidence now in what's going on. But if it does hit hard, congratulations. You full stop in the wow. That means you are really getting to the root of your frame of reference and saying, this is useless to me. It will always be utterly useless to me. I will always be utterly useless, meaning this frame of reference, which we believe is what we are, that we believe we have to function in this frame of reference. And to say, I can never function. I can never be functional. I can never be functional. I can never help anyone in any way. I can never have any role to play. I'm absolutely useless. Wow. I don't have any viewpoint whatsoever. I don't understand anything at all about this world. I can never understand anything about anyone. I'll never be able to understand anything about anyone. So not just I don't understand, I'll never be able to understand anything about any context, in any context, person, thing, place, whatever. In no way will I ever be able to understand anything about any context whatsoever. I am completely stupid. I am completely stupid. Meaning the context of time, the attempt to induce abnormality, the context of time, space, process, and form, we'll just say time, completely meaningless. I am completely meaningless. We say, I am completely meaningless. I am completely useless. I am completely without value. I will never have value or usefulness or understanding. I'll never be able to understand anything whatsoever. No context. In no way do I have even the slightest understanding of any context. I'm utterly stupid and will always be utterly stupid. So you might say this is kind of burning your bridges, right? It really is burning your bridges when you're practicing this way. Who's willing to burn their bridges? My bridges are aflame, that is for sure. It's best not to watch the bridges burn. Just turn your attention away from them into the wow. And say, well, my wow isn't burning at all. My wow is here beautifully. It's not burning at all. And my wow is like a flotation device. Like a life preserver. Oh, I got this life preserver on and I'm floating fine in the ocean. No problem. I know I'll be picked up soon by a most benevolent boat. So in no way do I want to try to understand the new frame of reference. We only put our efforts towards saying, I can never have any new frame of reference. I can never have the right frame of reference. I can never have the right frame of reference. My frame of reference will always be absolutely meaningless. My frame of reference will always be absolutely meaningless. Met a man today, I know he served in Vietnam, and I looked at him, I said, you know, you served in Vietnam? He said, yeah. How? He's a grunt, he said, just basic infantry man. And I said, you know what, you really don't show it. I mean, you got through much better than most. And he says, yeah, way better than most. And he said, yeah, I did. I said, so it's like you hardly, you know, it didn't affect you, you're not wearing it all. He says, oh, no, it I feel it, believe me, I feel it at times quite a bit, but yeah, I somehow have been able to, you know, to get through it and you know, wow my way through it. So, you know, when you go through an ordeal, you're going to feel it. This is like going through an ordeal right now. But the other option is not good at all, actually. The other option is not good at all. To not go through this ordeal is to fail to go through the ordeal. And that's not a good option right now. It's like a sweat lodge. You're in the sweat lodge, and boy, you know, you're just thinking, man, I don't know if I can make it through. But you say, well, you know, that's what I'm here for. That's what I'm here for, is to make it through. So then you really buckle down. And I'm not sleeping well at all. I don't even pretend that I'm going to sleep well. I said, you know, I woke up this morning at 3:33. It's weird. I can't explain it that I either wake up at 3:33 or 4:44. And it's all dark, and I look at my watch, hit the light, on my watch and it says 4:44 or this or 3:33. It's never like 3:26 or 3:13 or 4:07. It's never that. It's always 3:33 or 4:44. It's inexplicable. It's very inexplicable. And I just say, come on. I have no idea what time it is. I say, maybe it's, 5:30 in the morning. I don't know. Oh, no. 3:33. Oh, gosh. I said, uh-oh. I got a long morning ahead of me, don't I? Yeah, I'm getting up at 7:30, 3:30, 7:30. That's 4 hours. 4 hours to practice. I said, well, great. 4 hours to practice. But I didn't do so good this morning because I'm really, struggling. But Jesus' advice is say, hey, there's nothing that I can do. There's absolutely nothing that I can do. There's no way that I can ever help anyone. There is no way that I can ever help anyone. Okay, that one hit. So there you go. That one really connected. Now we grow up. Everything that we're saying right now is exactly what everyone in this world taught us to never say or never feel, think or feel. They say, you can never feel that way. Never, never, never let your mind go there. I can never help anyone in any way. No, 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 you're very helpful. You're very helpful. But of course, that's the context of time speaking, believing that you're helping reinforce the notion that we can induce abnormality in reality, when in fact we can't. I mean, if we said that, I can never help anyone in any way, everyone would say, oh my God, you're so depressed, gotta go see a shrink, come on, this is horrible, you can't think that way, you're very useful, you're very helpful, everybody loves you, I say, no, 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 I can never help anyone in any way, which is true. The context of time is utterly valueless to us, totally meaningless and valueless to us, doesn't help us in any way. What we're saying here is totally blasphemous to the world. But it's not blasphemous to Jesus, that's for sure. Not blasphemous to the Dharma kings. I can never understand anything. I'll never have the slightest understanding of anyone. I will never have the slightest understanding of anyone. So give yourself plenty of time and you're practicing to let the shock, wear off and use the wow. I've got a hold of the wow and the wow is here perfectly for me. It hasn't melted down at all. It's in great shape. It's in perfect shape. I can never, I'll never be able to help anyone at all. I'll never be even the slightest help to anyone. I will never be even the slightest help to anyone. I'll never be able to give anyone any help at all. That's a very, very profound statement, isn't it? And also very true. However, when the frame of reference spontaneously shifts, it is help itself. There's no I giving the help. It's just the help. It just is the help. Again, we don't want to be in some sort of hurry here. Because this is shocking to hear yourself say this. It flies in the face of every teaching in the world, almost. The teacher that I feel is closest to the way that I am, closest, it's not an exact fit at all, but close, would be Nisargadatta Maharaj. He's willing to say so directly, just so directly, that stuff that we just go, what? It really challenges. I happened to see his video, the video that I made on him, his quotes, which is really a very wonderful video. It's got over 10,000 views. I had no idea. I had not even looked at it. So a lot of people are watching it, actually, which is great, which is really great. And I saw he watched some of it, and I just said, wow, Jai Guru. Jai Maharaj, really. What he says is just so profound. It's very similar to what we're saying here. It seems easy now to listen to what he has to say. Just say, yeah, Jai Maharaj. So wonderful. It's not an exact fit, but no one will be an exact fit. But it's kind of more like, he's just a nobody with no education in Bombay. And just did what his guru, trusted in his guru, and he succeeded, just like I'm trusting in the new way of Jesus here, the new way, and I'm just doing what he suggests, just trusting in it. That's it. I have faith in what is in his advice. That's all that Maharaj did, and it worked for him, and it'll work for me as well, what Jesus is saying. So, and then he just, kept a very low profile, and people came to see him, and gradually, a lot of people paid attention, books are written, etc. And he ended up being, useful. His awakening itself was useful. The context was useful. The frame of reference was useful. And it's useful to this day. And it's part of the flavor of our modern age right now. His style that he had. And he didn't put up with any nonsense, he really didn't. He wasn't a charismatic guru. He wasn't a love guru. He was a yani, he just said, and he really said, practice, you got to just practice this, stop digging for a pathway that answers will take you on. Stop that right now. That does will not benefit you at all. Say, I am completely useless. I will always be completely useless. I'm a completely useless failure. I will always be an absolute, complete, total failure. Now, he certainly intimated that by everything he said. He said, no, basically, he says, your persona, your I, is complete failure, is nothing. We'll never give you anything. Well, that's complete failure, isn't it? So I am a total complete failure. I always will be, too. There's no way I can be redeemed at all. There is no way I can be saved. There is no way that I can be redeemed at all. Okay, so this obviously flies in the face of a lot of teachings of religion. You know, the idea of I can be redeemed. No, there's no way I can be redeemed. The context of time cannot be redeemed or saved. It cannot, nothing can be done to it to be helpful to us in any way. Jesus said, the Holy Spirit knows not of time. The only helpful use of time is to use it to reshape our expectations that time is completely useless. That's it. So it's funny, I was complaining that there's nothing in the world today, there's nothing in the world that I can follow. I said, what role models do I have in the world, in history? Where are they? There aren't any. So I feel like, wow, that's very tough. I'm afraid, like, how will I function, you know, without any role models? Well, and then I come across this video that I made on Maharaj, and I said, wow, right there is a pretty good role model, actually. Function like that. The spiritual path is always the ego, trying to spiritualize the ego. So, say this, the spiritual path is completely useless to me. The spiritual path is absolutely useless to me. The only usage of a path is to emphasize that the spiritual path is completely useless to me. All spirituality is an attempt to spiritualize the ego, actually. What we are doesn't need any spiritualization at all. When the frame of reference completely shifts for you, all this will be immediately apparent, and you'll know exactly what we're talking about here. You'll say, wow, I didn't even realize this was possible. Of course. Now it makes perfect, you know, it's very clear and obvious to me, of course. There's no mystery at all. Now I see why I practice this way. Now I see, you know, I see what it's all about. But again, it is very counterproductive to try and describe what it is you're experiencing, because then everyone will try to make a path, an aim, a pathway, try to turn it into a goal, trying to turn it into an answer, you know, and turn it into learning, which would will actually, you know, be very counterproductive for everyone, actually. So faith is required. Faith is required. You don't want to get in your own way with expectations. It's better to have your expectations not knowing. I don't know anything. I don't know anything. I can never know anything. I can never understand anything. I'll never be able to understand anyone. Never be able to understand anyone or anything. This world realm, all of this will always be a complete mystery to me. Total mystery. I'll never be able to figure anything out. And as you go along, you'll make adjustments. I made some adjustments today. Someone help me out. Absolutely. Out of the blue, someone came over and helped me out. Gave me this really great suggestion that really helped me. And then I said, okay, I've got to, I was practicing my golf swing there. It's very interesting. And I'm at this place, and suddenly this guy taps me on the shoulder. And he said, and then he imitates a golf swing. He says, how's it going? And you know, I said, well, I'm working on it. Do you play a little bit? I said, not yet. I said, where are you playing? And he said, I play there. I said, wow. I said, I should play there. I said, I never thought of that. I said, yeah, that would work out really well for me. They said, well, and then later on I thought, yeah, but I want this hat. You know, I want to look a certain way. I want to push it in a certain way. And so I need this hat. And so I found it online. I actually got two hats in two different colors. I said, I want this one and this one. And I want to go out with a certain, you know, in a certain focus, certain way. And so I did it. I said, boom, let's do it. Let's do this. So I'm working my way towards it. The less I play, the better I get. But the Holy Spirit's helping out, and the Dharma Kings are helping out. They're saying, you need to do this. You need to work your way in that direction. You need to be able to take the pressure off yourself. Because saying that people, we should assert in the way that we're asserting, practice in the way we're practicing, you know, you get a lot of pushback. I mean, it's there's a lot of doubts in everyone. Like, what? Like, no, I need to build my ego up. You know, I need to spiritualize my ego. The ego needs to be enlightened. Enlightenment is just for the ego. It's not for us at all. I'll never be enlightened. I will never, ever, ever be enlightened. Wow. See, what we are doesn't need enlightenment. And the ego, of course, will never be what we are. Enlightenment won't make the ego what we are. So what use is the word? I mean, what good is that word, really? We don't need enlightenment. We just need this shift in our frame of reference, really. Out of time. Jesus calls it the holy instant. The holy instant. The holy instant. I was able to experience that, the holy instant. Complete shift in my frame of reference. And he says, if you're willing to do that just for an instant, you will save yourself thousands and thousands of years of misery. It's that important. I was able to do it. I just had this moment where I just sort of let go of my old frame of reference, and I was willing to let go of it. I didn't know what I was going to let go into, and as soon as I let go of it, it's the holy instant. That was my frame of reference, and it's, you know, there's nothing I need to say about it. But just have faith that it's absolutely there. It's there as soon as you let go of the old frame of reference. Instantly, it's there for you. And you say, huh? I didn't know this was possible. Wow. That's wonderful. Yeah, that solves my trouble. I mean, that solves my troubles. Like, what am I going to do? How can I help this and this and all this stuff? I say, holy cow. Utterly simple, too. Jesus finishes this dialogue on awakening with the following words. Much of the time, you'll expect more from my answers than what I may give you, because they will appear to be too simple. You will say to yourself, there must be more involved in this. But I will say to you, as you allow yourself to hear the voice of simplicity, you will know you are hearing truth. Final words. The heat is great, summer heat, because you have to gather your resolve. Otherwise, you're just going to turn into a slug. You know, you got to gather your resolve. As they say, the cold, you can always put on more clothes and stay nice and warm. But in the heat, you can only take off so many clothes. You know, I mean, when it's really hot, you're going to feel it unless you got, you know, unless you jump in the pool or have air conditioning. So here, you know, it's hot. Nothing I could do about it except to gather my resolve. So you may come up with your own simple, I can never do this, I can never do that, that hit hard for you. Be the guru of your own practice. And it's unique for everyone, you know, different. You'll say something that for you, just you just feel it like, wow, that just hit home so hard for me, right? And it's slightly unique for all of us. And when it's this hot, everybody kind of expects one another just kind of be lounging anyway. So it's a great time to practice. You know, nobody says, hey, go out and pull weeds and do this and this. And I can say, ah, it's too hot. And they say, yeah, you're right, it's too hot. A friend of mine was out working on Sunday. I think it was 109 in his place. He's working like 6 hours, I think he did that. Finally, his wife called him and said, hey, come in and out of here. Come on in, get out of the sun. He goes, no, no, I got to finish. He goes, no, got to get out of the sun, you know, which is unusual. I think he says he has a never-ending honey-do list, but she finally relented and said, you know what? I got so many things for you to do. I don't want to lose you right now. So get out of the sun so you can work tomorrow. So sometimes, you know, the heat can be a good thing like that. We can get a reprieve from the honey-do list. Even the sternest taskmasters, they don't want to lose their slaves. So they'll give the slaves a break. Yeah. So I like it that way. The slaves get a break. And we're all slaves here to uselessness, aren't we? We most certainly are. To meaninglessness. To futility. So we all deserve a break. Even from working out, I said, they work out today. Nah, you know, it's too hot. And people will say, yeah, too hot. I said, I'll do it soon. I did do my balance exercises. I'm doing really well today on the balance. Maybe I'll do, you know, in the evening, I'll do some exercises, actually. Tomorrow's going to be a real scorcher, probably over 100. But nothing's as scorching as the practice we're doing. That's the real scorcher. And like I say, I love the heat. You know, the hottest I've been is like 113. But I'd love to be like 123, which I think it was down in the Palm Desert area of California yesterday. You know, it was up there. I think over 120. I mean, that'd be great. And that'd really give you an excuse to just sit quietly. But the inner heat that we're applying is like over 120. And we're really turning up the heat on our expectations, not to triumph over anything, but to get familiar with letting go of our expectations. There's nothing there. I don't have any value at all. I'll never have any value. I'll never be of use to anyone. I'll never be able to help a single soul in any way. I will never be able to help even a single soul in any way. Ever. You know, that's really powerful to hear that. And as we do that, devalue our expectations, what happens is out of the blue, we're suddenly willing to let it go. And by default, automatically it's there. The change of reference is there. A new frame of reference is there. We let go of our false perception, and true perception is there, so to speak. The true frame of reference is there. We let go of the false frame of reference of time, and the true frame of reference is there. And really, it's indescribably, you can say it's indescribably dot, 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 you know? And use any which word you want to, but we don't want to try to have some static description for learning purposes. There's no learning purposes to the new frame of reference at all. It's not something transferable to learning. It can never be a goal of learning. Can only be a goal that arises when we set down our false perspective of time, false context. And we'll only do that when we expect to do that. In this world, nobody will train you at all to expect to do that, except here. And those who are aligned with the Dharma King teaching, in one way or the other, the right teaching, to practice like that. Because otherwise, you'll never get help or advice to do this, to align your expectations towards really accepting. It's utterly useless, this frame of reference. Totally useless. I'll never be able to help a single soul, ever, in any way. I'll be totally useless to everyone, forever, in this frame of reference. So this is how we must practice, to devalue all that and change our expectations. Like, wow, I don't want this. And then the frame of reference shifts and we say, oh, yeah, this is what I want. Yeah, this is exactly what I want. That's what I was looking for. That's great. Not like that old frame of reference. That was horrible. Completely useless. But we can never do it as a learning, something learning. We have to do it as a literally melting down our expectations, which produces shock, which then we have to block the shock by full stop in the wow, patiently. Don't use any other reference. Don't use any other words. Just say, I'm just floating in the wow. You know, I got this flotation device, and it's working great. It's not sinking at all. So as long as I hold on to this, I won't sink. Easy. I was floating in a pool a while ago, and had this sort of styrofoam foam seat kind of thing, and I just sort of lay on it, and I was just floating in the water. It was wonderful because I wasn't sinking, and I gave up all effort to try and stop sinking, to prevent my sinking. I wasn't holding on to anything. I was just floating in the water beautifully without any effort at all. And so it's like that. The wow is like that. Just float in the water without any effort. But you need a flotation device for that. But the flotation device was such that it allows you to be immersed in the water up to your neck. Okay, it's not something you sit on like a surfboard, like on top of the water or something. This enables you to be immersed up to your neck, but you don't sink any further than that. Then you're just very relaxed. Never make the shift of reference your aim. Always make practicing your aim. Otherwise, you most certainly will get in your way, your own way, and get very confused. That's why I don't want to describe it. As soon as I describe it, the ego will seize upon it and say, yeah, That's your aim. Now I know what the aim is. Now I know how to be spiritualized. All I have to do is just have this experience, and I will be truly enlightened and spiritualized. So it's much better to leave it inexpressible, without description. Because now the ego doesn't know what you're talking about and can't, you know, claim, hey, this is it for me. This will do it for me. Keep in mind that no matter what explanation we give ourselves, the I will always still be utterly useless to everyone. The ego may start out hoping it can be useful, but ultimately, experience shows us, ultimately we realize, no, it's not useful at all. It's utterly futile. Wow, time is flying. How are we doing here? Okay. Getting our workout in here. When you get advice from like Sargadatta Maharaj, you say, wow, Maharaj, or Jai Maharaj. Don't think about it. Because it should hit you, hit your core. You feel like, without a doubt. This is true without a doubt. Jai Maharaj. As soon as I think about it, it becomes cloudy. But I don't need to think about it. It's without a doubt, it's true. Whew. Giants called up a rookie pitcher. This is on the news. I just looked at the news yesterday for the first time in years. And right away I said, you know what? That's their turnaround is starting. That starts the turnaround. That's the move they needed to make. They did it. This is a guy that was like the number one draft pick for them, who was very, very highly touted. People thought for sure this is the next big thing, and he's going to be up and helping the Giants really soon. He was that electric. His stuff was that great. And instead, he floundered. He lost his control. He couldn't control his stuff, and he floundered in the minor leagues. Ultimately, he stalled out for 3 years in the same place. And everybody thought, myself included, this guy's a flame out. He's never going to make it. He's a bust, a complete bust. But so he stuck with it. He kept working on it. And finally, what they did was they turned him into a relief pitcher instead of a starter. And that changed everything for him. Somehow, his mindset is suitable for that. And it clicked for him. And ever since then, he's been coming on like gangbusters. Amazing. And finally, he got the call up for the big league team. Congratulations, you know. That's a story of perseverance. To be that highly touted and to fall as badly and fail as badly as he did, that must have been extremely difficult for him to handle. And to persevere like he did, it is really very, very heartwarming. And to say, you know what? I read someone said, I've watched him pitch a lot recently, and I'll tell you what, he's really smart, really, really good, too. He's, for 7 years, he's toiled down in the minor leagues, and he's really applied himself, and he gets it. He really gets it now. Takes some out longer than others, right? But better late than never. He's not even that old right now, because he was drafted very young, I think. Maybe even out of high school or something, I'm not sure. But he was pretty young, so he still has a very good career ahead of him, actually. Maybe as a really great relief pitcher. Which is what they need. That's a start. And so we might take a long time here as we're toiling away. But as we persevere, we know we have the stuff. We have the right stuff. It's just we can't quite put it together. We just can't quite put it together. But you have to persevere. You have to labor. I feel like I've labored in the minor leagues for my whole life. But I said my goal is really to get to major leagues, and I'm not quitting. You know, I'm going to reach it. I don't have any other goal. So as long as I can keep toiling away and doing the best I can do, I'll keep doing that. And I believe that at some point, it'll really click for me, right? And it's just like that. The big league team told them, hey, we really like what you're doing, and don't be surprised if we call you up soon, actually. You know, gave him a heads up. I got the heads up from Longchenpa. He said, I really like what you're doing. You know, don't be surprised if, you know, you get a call up soon, so to speak, right? Yeah, don't be surprised. I mean, we got our eye on you. We like the way that you're developing, and we believe you can be helpful to us. It's very similar to what a big league team does to a minor leaguer when they see that they really get it. They say, okay, you know, we really got our eye on you. We really like what we see. And we feel you could help us out at some point. So, you know, really stick with it intensely right now. That's how it goes. It goes like that. And it could be as simple as learning a new pitch. And then suddenly that new pitch makes all their other pitches much better because the batters really don't know what's coming. And it could just completely change their effectiveness. That happens a lot of times. Someone has a great fastball and a slider and stuff, but someday someone shows them a changeup. Just try this, and somehow it clicks for them, and they develop a great changeup. And then suddenly that makes their fastball just, you know, devastating. And suddenly they become this devastating pitcher. It's just wonderful. Whereas before, the hitters could still, you know, get to their fastball at times. And so suddenly the equation changes. Suddenly the equation can change for us. So in no way should we ever give up hope that our practicing will do anything but bear the fruit that our destiny has for us. The spiritual path is for the ego always, and no path at all is for us. But as long as we're here in this world, we're going to have perception, concepts, and expectations to some extent. So we need to reshape our expectations rather than just trying to just to have none. Reshape our expectations enough so that our frame of reference is able to fundamentally shift. I can't do anything at all. I really just can't do anything at all. I really just can't do anything at all. Does this cause depression? Or does feeling that you have no right to say this cause depression? Some intuitive psychotherapists may have touched upon this from time to time in their therapy. Is they let the client say whatever they want to say, and they say, hey, say something really negative about yourself. You know, maybe that'll really help you. Maybe people never allowed you just to express the doubt you have about the I, about your role that the world gives you. Why don't you just say, hey, I feel I'm completely useless. I really feel I'm completely useless. Instead of trying to talk them out of that, why don't you say, go ahead, say it. It's perfectly fine, perfectly okay. You need to say that. You need to hear yourself say that. The I that the world tells you, the role that you have to play, I feel it's completely useless. I don't know what I am at all. I don't know what that is about at all. I'll never know what it's about. I'll never know what it's about. And people feel this, like, I just don't know what this is about. But they feel that they're evil or wrong or bad, should be condemned for feeling this way. And just the opposite, actually. You should be lauded for feeling this way. I'll never know what this is about at all. I'll never know what this world's about. I really will never know what this world's about at all. And that's a statement of freedom, actually. So Jesus, I call him like the ultimate psychotherapist, really. He really knows what truly helps us and has the compassion to tell us to do it. Most, maybe other psychotherapists would have their license yanked. I mean, there's some that are strong enough, powerful enough, they can do this. I don't know about these days, probably not. The licensing and everything is just this massive bureaucratic net in the world that we want to stay away from. Maybe you can't do that anymore. You've got to build up their self-esteem. You know, we have to say, I am important. My role in the world is really important. I can do a lot of good for people. You know, I can, which really just makes them even sicker. Which pharmaceutical companies love, right? Say, gee, psychotherapy itself ain't working. Let's combine therapy and medication. That should do it. And then later on they say, you know what? Looks like the medication's working better than the therapy, so the therapy's going to be really expensive for the insurance, so let's just shift over to just medication. That should work. And that's what's happened in the world. Used to be therapy was all about avoiding medication. I think of Jesus as this ultimate therapist. And here I am having therapy, getting a client of Jesus. And Jesus encouraged me. He said, just say this. Just say, go ahead and say it. Say how you feel. You have my permission to say it. Yeah, I'm completely useless. I don't know what this world's about at all. I'll never know what this world's about. I'll never even have a clue about what this world's about, Jesus. Never even have a clue about it. Great. Wow. Say it again. I'll never have a slightest clue about what this world's about or what anybody's about. I'll never know what anybody's about at all. I'll never understand anyone. I'll never even have a clue of what anything's about here. Nothing, nothing, nothing. Great. How's it feel? It was shocking. Wow. Okay, full stop in the wow then. I actually asked Jesus if he'd be my therapist. And he responded, sure. He said, I'm looking for clients. You know, nobody hardly ever asks me. I think they already know what I say, but it's not about what I say, it's about what you, I'm encouraging how you, for you to practice. You're the one who needs to practice, it's not me. So, not many come and say, okay, Jesus, I want you to be my psychotherapist. Well, that's what I did. And boy, did he come through with a new way here. He said, just say this. Try saying this. I said, oh my gosh, what's going to happen? He said, just trust me. You're in therapy with me. Trust the therapist. Just say this. So I said, okay, I'm in therapy. Let's give it a try. Might as well. I'm not going to walk away from therapy just after one session, you know? Give him a chance. Give the therapist a chance here. So literally, I'm in therapy with Jesus. He's my therapist. I really asked him to fulfill that role, and I believe he certainly agreed. He said, yeah, absolutely. Now, when he came to me in the dream, he was sitting down and very calm, and he didn't say anything. That's often what a therapist does. He's just there. Okay, I'll just sit here quietly, and let's see what you want to say. Let's see what comes up. And I said, Jesus, I'd like to say this. He says, all right. That's a good start. Let's do it. Go ahead. I highly advise doing that. It's a very good suggestion to start that way. Yeah. Wow. I don't have any value at all. I'll never have any value. How does that feel? Shocking. Great. It's really hitting those expectations, huh? I said, yeah, it is. Wow. Really, really, really hitting those expectations. Okay, let's block the panic then. Hitting a little flat spot, seeming to be tired. Haven't been sleeping for a long time. I feel surprisingly well. I really do. It's not like before. I'm not nearly as run down as before. If I didn't get no sleep like this before, I would have just been really, really zonked out. But I'm really not that zonked out, actually. I'm getting some naps. But I feel strangely buoyant. Energized and buoyant, such that there's so much. I'm in therapy with Jesus. I mean, that hardly gets any better, right? I mean, I'm not going to, get sluggish here. I'm going to keep practicing. This is an opportunity. Back in the day, there were some therapists that were so big, people vied to have them as their therapist, so they could, various reasons, you might say, there's two motivations. One's genuine, the other one is to be they want to be a cultural paragon of culture, to be viewed as a paragon of culture, and so they can get the gravitas to say, I had this therapist, and this means that I'm really unimpeachable in terms of a paragon of culture. But those who go for legitimately, they really want to shift their frame of reference. They would really, these big time therapists back in the day, these were the real movers and shakers in high culture. Is these therapists, psychotherapists. They were at the top. There's lots of men, Alexander Lowen, Fritz Perls, Arthur Janoff, Werner Erhard with Est, you might say. Then the gurus came in, they're really psychotherapists. Many, though, really. What was that? I would recognize all the names, really, because they were the big dogs, and I was thinking, wow, maybe I could get therapy with them. So I read all their books, so that I could think like I could understand what their therapy's about. I took Arthur Janoff's therapy, not with him though, And yeah, there's a lot to it, actually. There's a lot to it. He was on to something, meaning you should be able to express. He said there's what hit for his thing was there's a scream of frustration in us, you know. But it is temporary. It's sort of temporary. Temporary relief. So they all had something, you know. It's kind of like the wise people in a tent. They grab a hold of an elephant in the dark, and they all have a hold of something. So I know I got something here. There's something here, but none of them quite see the entire elephant. But boy, were they, you know, boy, did they have authority then to, you know. Until they got undermined. Yeah. Pharmaceutical companies said, you know, we don't want too much effective psychotherapy here, and let's undermine them. We want failure of psychotherapy, because that's what brings us profits. We don't want everyone to just have this talk to a wise therapist and find the relief that they're looking for and realize, wow, I feel really great about myself. My health's really great. Everything's really great. I don't feel the slightest need for any medication at all. So gradually, you know, they were undermined. Any pretext will do, right? When you're against something, they can do no right. They can do no right. And when you're really for them, they can do no wrong. You know, it depends on your motive, how you're looking at it. I don't think Jesus, you know, cares about the profits of the pharmaceutical industry and healthcare industry too much. I believe he is giving us all the best advice. Okay, he's not holding something back, saying, you know, and I don't really want you to get completely well, because, you know, you should, you know, be taking some medications, and, you know, right? I mean, let's kind of please both sides here. No, he's saying, this is how you get, you know, have perfect mental health, actually, and nothing will bother you, actually. But he would not pinpoint it on any in particular industry or anything like that. You'd be more abstract about it. It's the ego. It's very abstract. You know, it's the ego. The ego's trying to have a spiritual path. And medication is an essential part of the ego's spiritual path. The ego says, this is how I feel good. This is how I feel good. I know how to feel good. Chemicals. The ego say, yeah, I tried that spiritual stuff, but chemicals work a lot better for me, a lot easier, helps me be more productive, buy more things, which I'm told will make me happy also. I don't want to spend 10 years in a hippie commune listening to some guru. I want to make a lot of money and buy a bunch of stuff, and I feel that will make me happy. So the medications get me back on the road, and you know, yeah, there's a lot of side effects and stuff, but at least I'm back on the road earning a lot and getting that nice house. Don't aim for results, because then you'll have a path. Just practice. Practice devaluing the I, the context of time. Devalue your expectations. Reshape your expectations. This is the smooth way when I shifted into the holy instant. Well, as smooth as can be. It was just, I just kind of felt like, oh, you know? The old frame of reference just didn't really have any juice for me anymore, and I just kind of felt like, you know, a new frame of reference would be great. And there it was. I said, oh, this is way better. I love this. Okay. It was that simple, gentle. But you can't really induce it directly. You have to, indirectly, just simply, your expectations have just changed to the extent that, you know, you're tired. You see what's useless and futile, and you're just not interested in it anymore. And you expect us to, you know, not be interested in that anymore. And it doesn't cause any shock when you're not interested in it. And that automatically, the holy instant will arise for you, like that frame of reference shift. There's nothing that the world can do for me. The world cannot help me in any way. Absolutely will never be helped by the world in any way. That's another powerful one, isn't it? So we're doing this in terms of therapy, in terms of practice, not with an aim or a path of learning or anything like that, just merely directly reshaping our expectations. That's all we're doing here. And then just having faith that this is what works. That's all. I put faith in Jesus. I said, you know, I really feel like it's worth doing this. You say this will get the results. I really feel that I can trust you on this. And whether I get the results or not, I feel for sure this is the right thing to do. I really feel this is the right way to practice. So I'm going to practice. I'm not going to not do something that I feel is the right thing to do. I'm going to do it. And I don't have any particular results in mind at all. No, I just keep practicing properly. It's like walking across a bridge in the dark, in the dark or in the fog, and Jesus says, "Yeah, there's the bridge is connected to the other side. When you get to the other side, you're really gonna love it. I promise you this." I say, "Well, Jesus, I can't really see the other side because it's all foggy." He says, "I know. Just keep walking anyway. Trust me on this. Just keep walking, one step after the other. Don't put any attention on the other side. Just put attention on taking one step after the other." This actually happened to me on the Golden Gate Bridge. I was wanting to do a video, and I was walking across it, and it became extremely foggy. And all I could see was basically about one step ahead of me on this bridge. It was scary. I mean, the Golden Gate Bridge is scary enough anyway. But to feel like it all disappeared, and all you could see was just barely around you, the next step, and you couldn't see anything else at all. It was daytime and the lights weren't helping. Nothing was helping. It's incredible. And I just said, okay, I'm just going to take one step at a time and just focus on just that. And I know this bridge is connected to the land. If I just keep doing this, I'm going to get to the land. Okay, and get off this bridge. Right. So that was a really great experience and very tiring. It was nerve-wracking. Because your mind starts playing tricks on you. It really did try to start playing tricks. The mind says, what if, you know, there's a hole in the bridge, you know, or what if there's a crack? What if there's a gap? You know, what if you're going the wrong direction and there's a guardrail is gone? You know, all this, like, panic tried to seize upon me, like that. And I just refused. I said, no, I'll just take the next step. Or if panic got really bad, I just gather my resolve a little bit and say, no, that's just foolish. That's not true. Those are just wild, you know, that's wild, panicky fear. throwing at anything imaginable. And I said, I know this is, I'm on the sidewalk. I know this is the way. I know this is the way. I saw it before. I could see that there's no gaps or anything. So just keep going and everything will be fine. So that's a super profound practice. Walking across the Golden Gate Bridge when it's super foggy. Wow. That's a difficult one. That would spook the best of us. I mean, you talk about having to gather your resolve. But we're kind of, in essence, we're doing something like that, aren't we? It's foggy. We're not really sure, you know, what the results, what's going to be like, any of that stuff. And but we've got no choice. It's going to be foggy. So we just have to have faith and keep walking. Get to the other side of the bridge and you say, wow. What a view. Wow. This is way, way better than anything I could ever have imagined or expected, actually. And in the meantime, you know, if you're really practicing, you know, you may not be sleeping so great. At least I'm not. That's the price I'm willing to pay. You know, I'm willing to pay that price. And, you know, I get my naps and catch up on sleep and do the best I can. And keep being very, very confident and enthusiastic and feeling of certainty and knowing that, you know, I'm like I'm already there. I'm already there, actually. I've already succeeded. I've already shifted my frame of reference. Wow. The new frame of reference is with me. Wow. You can practice in this way. The new frame of reference is already with me. Wow. The frameless frame of reference is already with me. Frameless frame of reference is already with me. The enlightened free enlightenment is already with me. The enlightenment free enlightenment is already present with me. Wow. I am the presence. I am the enlightenment free enlightenment presence. Try that. I am the enlightenment free enlightenment presence. Wow. I am the guru-free guru presence. I am the guru-free guru presence. Wow. Psychotherapy with Jesus. Hallelujah. No charge, you know. It's free. Just have to, you know, do the work, do the practice. I am the enlightenment-free enlightenment presence. The enlightenment-free enlightenment presence. I am the success-free success. I am the liberation-free liberation. The arrival-free arrival, the abidance-free abidance. I'm in the abidance-free abidance. I am the abidance-free abidance presence. I am the abidance-free abidance presence. So, just catch the drift, you know, maybe catch the scent of this. All right, very great. Just wow it, and wow it, and then wow it some more, and that wow keeps you buoyant. You won't sink. Wow.